Good morning. This is the program is Horticulturally Yours, and no, you have the right person. Dr. Barry Palmer is not able to be here today. He has a family emergency, so I am Dieter Wolter. I'm the owner of Temple Greenhouse, and he asked me to host this lovely program today. We have a terrific guest, Mrs. Grace Kline. She is the president of the Garden Club of Muhlenberg and all kinds of other things. She says she doesn't want to mention too many things, but I think we're going to have a great time. The topic today is going to be dried flowers. And also, eventually, I'm going to be giving you some hints as far as the gardening is concerned. So, Gracie, you go ready, baby.
Okay, thank you.
All right, let's go to it.
Okay, I decided to talk about dried flowers today. Usually that's something that you do in the fall. But I thought in getting you prepared as to what to plant so that you have these things in the fall would be a good idea. So, first of all, there's many ways of drying plants. You can air dry them. You can use microwave with silica gel, or I have something else here, which I had gotten. This is called microfluor, and what it is a little container like this, and you lift it off, and it's like a little sandwich. You put your fresh flowers in here. Now, you can either take them apart petal by petal if you want to do it that way, or you can, if they're real thin, you can put them on here. And what you do is you put your flowers on here, then you sandwich it in like this, and you put your clips in each side. And you put it in your microwave. Now, it depends on your thickness of your flower, so you have to experiment in the summertime. If it's a very, very thin flower, it doesn't take very, very long. You just have to experiment, maybe a minute to 3 minutes, depending on your flowers. And it's a very, very easy thing to do. Now, there's another way to use your microwave also, and you use something called silica gel, which is, if you would take a blossom and you would put some of this silica sand in the bottom of your bowl, you place a flower and very carefully put this sand around it. Now, you don't have to use a microwave. You could let it sit for a couple of weeks. But if you want fast results, put it in your microwave. But also add a cup of water on the side, not into the bowl of flowers, but on the side so that your microwave doesn't catch fire. But that's another way. You can hang things to dry, and there's all sorts of things you can do.
I still like the old-fashioned way.
Which way?
Telephone book.
Well, I have that. I have that. I'm going to get to that. We have the telephone book, which is the most popular with a lot of gardeners. And what you do is you pick your flowers, and now this is from last year. I pressed a fern, and you can see it kept its color, and you can use it for all different kinds of crafts that I'm going to be showing you. All kinds of flowers. Put something heavy on the top so that it presses flat. Now, you can also, when you dry flowers, these are called faux flowers, or they are called flowers made out of, well, this one's particularly made out of corn husks. And usually I let them dry out for a while, not that they're real, real dry, but then I can cut them and shape them and form them, and then I pick leaves and let them dry naturally, just about any kind of leaf. And if you don't like the color, you can always paint it if you're not a naturalist and you don't want it all, you know, original color. The center is a little pod from one of my flowers, a little brown pod. And then I wrapped it with floral tape. And it's ready to make a bouquet with. This one is a different type of flower, still made out of the corn husks. And this is out, the center of this one is a Rose of Sharon bud, which I used with that, and I wrapped that. This is going to be hard to see because it's so dark, but this is a eucalyptus leaf, and I have some little, they're weeds really, little pink, I forget what the name of them are, but I use those for the center of that. And this is also a corn husks I use for the leaf, and also I used it to make the little daisy button flower with. And the center of this is from a Monarda plant, the little bud. But you can make several of these. And then these are nice in the fall to use with different things, which I'll be showing you. Put this aside. Some of the things that you can do are when you want to press a flower, you can make pictures such as this. This is one of Gene Burkhart's I'm honored to have. He passed away last year. This is one I did for one of our garden club flower shows. And this one is an Edelweiss, which I had the opportunity and the pleasure of visiting Switzerland a few weeks ago. I've tried to grow Edelweiss a couple times and I've given up. So when I was over there, I decided to buy some frames, so I'll have it.
Okay. It's not that difficult to grow. They just...
They don't last.
Yes, they do. Do you have to remember where their natural habitat is?
But I have a natural...
They're way up in the mountains.
But I live on a mountain.
Real crappy soil.
Yes, me.
And that's where full sun. And that's where the plants, the Edelweiss will grow.
Really, in full sun.
Full sun.
See, I have a lot of pines in shade.
No, that's not going to work.
Yeah, but I tried.
No wonder you kill them.
Yeah. I tried like a couple times, and it just didn't work. So, anyway, I do have my Edelweiss, and I will...
I do have plans to sell you later, though.
Do you?
Yes.
I'll try it again and see what happens, and I'll put them in a sunny spot.
Yes.
And I'll put them under a fence so that the bunnies don't decide to eat them for me. Okay, we have several different kinds of flowers in here. The larkspur, of course, and the fern, and just little miniature daisies. And you can make miniature daisies, or you can make miniature faux flowers out of maybe pieces of hydrangea blossoms. Here we have a little wreath. And this is done, now these are all pretty old things that I have, that I have sitting in my home. Here I have dried rosebuds, and I have baby's breath, and I have rose leaves on here. You can also use bay leaves, which are very good. And here, well, let's do this next. Bookmarkers, you can press them. This is between plastic. And these are some of the cards that you can make. Different kinds of cards using different kinds of flowers. You can cut some flowers that maybe look like butterflies. You have to use your imagination. Pansies. That's just the envelope. This was our garden club book that we made in 2002. Now that's a long time ago. So in, I think it's May, we are set up and we're going to make new books because now these pictures, these flowers have faded. And so we decided that we would make some new books. And we have, every girl did their own design. Everyone is different. It was nice to see what everybody came up with. And then, of course, on the back, I have my initials and the date. But they last pretty long. The cards, this is another one. This is using holly leaves. and also Queen Anne's lace in the center of that. Now here are some samples of dried. These are excellent to dry. These are those little, would you call them violas?
Violas. Johnny Jump Ups.
Johnny Jump Ups, yeah. They're great. And you can put these in, you can get a whole lot in a phone book and press them. Also, just grass leaves are interesting. If you can see, dry those. They're wonderful to put spikes and things on if you're doing a picture. And these are the larkspur. These are the dark blue larkspur. There are several different kinds. There's pink, there's white, there's lighter colored blue. Let me see. Oh, that's some more larkspur. These are miniature roses that are dried on the stem, and you can see there are some buds on there yet. These are pressed. Now, if you want to dry roses, these miniatures, I have one rose bush that's called the fairy, the little fairy rose, and that blooms from June until November. It's one of the last roses in my garden. And you can pick those and you can air dry them. Just turn them upside down and they'll last a long time. Okay, these are the zinnia, the orange zinnias. And these are the flat ones. There's all kinds of zinnias. These have just one row of petals around the center. And of course, these are just some leaves that to pick and dry. Try different things. It's very interesting to see what you can get. Some other things that we do with dried flowers are we make potpourri with it. And what you do with that is you can air dry that. Or I have a stand with like shelf screens and I lay the petals on.
You on that one.
Oh, okay. I lay the petals on this screen, and they dry, they dry naturally with the air getting through. If you don't have such a thing, before I had this set up, I used to take the rack out of my stove and tip it on the edge of the fireplace, and just to get the grate on it, and then I'd put paper towels on top of that, and then I'd lay my petals on top of that. And that works pretty good. But to make potpourri, you can gather your things in the fall, and you can add all sorts of things to them. But one thing you have to remember, don't start mixing your flowers and spices and so forth until they're perfectly dry, because if you do, you'll open this and it'll be all moldy inside. So be sure it's like cornflakes, real crispy. This is one. This is one that you can make little bags and put them in with your sweaters and things for the fall. It has some rose geranium that is very, very good, and that deters moths and so forth. There's a lot of books that you can pick up. This is a Christmas one I did with a few years ago with bay leaves that I dried, and then, of course, the dried pine cones. If you're going to bring pine cones in, we had a storm the year before in October. Probably a lot of people remember that one. And these were all baby pine cones that fell from the branches. I had a lot of downfall with the branches and so forth. But when I brought them in, I didn't just dry them. I put them in the oven in a very low temperature and really dry them out very well so that they can, yes. I never know where this camera is. So anyhow, you can use the pine cones in a different thing. You can wire them for miniature arrangements if you want to. And there's a lot of books that are out, and if you don't have the book, then go to the library. They have them, and the bookmarks, they all have them, stores. But this is a good one by Eugene Burkhart. These are little ones, preserve your posies. and that's by the Leisure Arts. And then there's this old one I have, Pressed Flower Craft. There's a lot of things on the market with different crafts and so forth.
Yeah, we're going to be missing Eugene because in the springtime, as soon as the flowers started blooming, he was out there in the greenhouse with his trusty scissors or shears and started snipping away on some of the flowers. I think, we'll definitely miss him.
Yeah, he was a friend to the garden club also.
Yes, indeed.
When called upon, he always helped us out with some kind of a program or so forth. You can also, if you want to really get elaborate, this is a little fairy necklace, and this is made with the miniature rosebuds and little pearls and ribbons. Now, most of these things here, like I said, this must be about 10, 12 years old, this arrangement, and I can see it's had its day, but I thought I'd bring it along. The nice thing about this is when you do this, you can make an arrangement. This was made on a candlestick, and I had this in my living room for a long time. These are the dried hydrangeas, and this here is the Sweet Annie. The Sweet Annie, I usually, it really smells wonderful. You want to air dry that, and you just turn it upside down and let it dry till it's dried out. There are some lemon leaves here, which I did not grow. Those you can buy at any florist will have those. But it's just to give you an idea. This was made about 10 years ago, I guess. This has, again, it has the wheat and the eucalyptus and the dried roses. And we use it like a swag. You can hang it on a door. And like I said, it's pretty old. So a lot of these things must be refreshed again. Over here, we have, of course, the Oriental Pussy Willows. And there, right now is a good time to pick them. If you want them to come out fuller, I had these in water for a couple days. But you can start picking them in February. Put them in water and enjoy them. And then when they get really full like this and the pussies all come out on their stem, take them out of the water and they'll last, for a long, long time, from year to year. Dieter brought something very interesting in. This is a papyrus. Can you tell us a little bit about the papyrus?
Well, it's a water plant that, but it can be grown in the garden. It is not a perennial, but it is... We have two sizes. The one gets about 3 to 4 feet tall, and the other one gets about almost 6 feet tall, the flowers. This is actually the flower, and it holds up fantastically. What we did is it dried on the plant itself, and all we did is use a little bit of green paint on it, spray floral paint, and it really held up gorgeously, and it preserved the it gives it that loose, airy feeling that any arrangement really lacks. So yes, it's in olden days they used to make the paper out of it. That's why it's a papyrus.
Now, how much water would you say you really need to have these plants sunk in?
You don't really have to have them in water, but just as long as you keep them moist.
So if you have a real thin pool like I have,
yeah,
I can sit the plant in there?
Absolutely.
Very good.
Because in the wintertime, when we take them in the fall, we have them actually just in an 8-inch pot or something like that because it needs the size of the pot. And I think some of them we had in a 12-inch pot so they wouldn't fall over. And in the wintertime, most of the people sink them in water in a tub. And then let them overwinter that way. Actually, we just left them sit on the greenhouse bench, and it went down to 40 degrees, and it was just fine. Now we separated them, and now they're starting to grow again.
Well, this is very, very interesting. I just love the flow of it. It's very pretty. And I'm thinking about something in the fall that I
and
might be able to
use. And
this
is actually only about
for
a medium-sized one. There are some that get twice the size of that one. They really get huge.
Well, I love it. Thank you for bringing that in. Also over here we have the yarrow, which is very easy to raise. It likes sunshine. And you pick it when it's fully opened. And you can save this from year to year to year. And another good thing about this, like I've used them at Christmas time, and I spray painted them red. Or you can paint them like a deep burgundy around the holidays. But that's something nice to grow. So you have something in the summer, and then you have something useful to play with in the fall and
well,
winter.
The yarrow comes in different colors. You're mm-hmm. going to have orange ones, you're going to have the yellow ones, and they all dry fantastically well. It's just amazing how well they hold up. It's like some of the other things, too, that are commercially available, like the straw flowers. The gumfrina is a little purple thing.
That's gumfrina.
That's this one here.
Yeah.
It is really fantastic. All you have to do is hold it upside down and holds the color beautifully. You don't have to squish it or anything like that. It just dries naturally. The straw flower is even better. You can have them in a hanging basket or in a pot, and they will throw those little flowers out, and all you have to do is put a wire in it, and it will dry really good. It's almost like a paper product that it will be really nice. So,
and if you're going to wire it, what you want to do is take your wire and push it up through the flower. It goes for straw flowers also. Push it up through the head of the flower and then gently bend the tip and then pull it back. And that holds it on the flower head.
Right.
So this is a wreath that's made out of eucalyptus with little rosebuds on it. And I'm just trying to think here. Okay. I have brought this along. We made these in our herb society, and I just thought they were so cute. I'm going to put a placemat so that you can see it underneath the placemat. But we all did different designs, and this was the one I liked. So we made placemats, and then you can make coasters also. And that's just dried. Again, you can press your ferns in there. I'll tell you what else is nice. The Japanese maple leaves are wonderful and very colorful to do that with. So do you have any other names of flowers, Dieter, that are good for drying?
I think the hydrangea is the most underused flower. People always come and say, well, how do I get them pink or blue or whatever? And they don't realize that once the frost comes, they dry beautifully right on the plant. All you have to do is cut them, and you don't have to do anything to them. They just last and last. Like last year, I think I brought in a whole bunch of blue ones for my wife, and she says, what am I supposed to do with it? I says, just put it in a vase. It's going to be gorgeous. And they hold up really well. The other one that's an old-fashioned plant, the coxcomb, mm-hmm. All you have to do is hang it upside down, and it dries perfectly, whether you have the plume one or the comb itself. They hold up really well. Gumfrina, we mentioned before, that's an old one. Well, naturally with me and German plants, the Edelweiss is always good. And we do have plants that we sell, and they bloom, and all you have to do is pick the flower. And that you would have to either wire, or you would have to put it in between something so that it folds up really nice. The papyrus we mentioned. There's a heather also works really well. Right around Easter time, you should be able to get some heather or either Christmas or other. As long as you don't disturb them, they hold up well. If you disturb them, I would always suggest spraying them with a sealer lacquer. The dried flowers hold up better that way with the sealer on it. And it acts almost like a glue and holds things a little better together.
I don't have any lavender here, but lavender you can also dry. The most important thing about when you're picking lavender to dry is to pick it before it blooms, when it's in full bud. And because once the flower opens, you've lost it. So if you have lavender, cut it when it's ready to pop, cut it, and and it smells so really good. And the honesty plant, of course. The Lunaria, Silver Dollar, people talk about that name. Right now, it's starting to form, and in spring, when it gets into the springtime, maybe into June, I will have this practically all over my property. It gets a very, very pretty pink flower. And when the flower dies off, then these little pods form, and this lasts indefinitely. And this also looks good year-round with different things. They look good with the pussy willows. They look good with the yarrow. I also have some iris pod here someplace. I'll come across it. But the iris pods, after your iris bloom, don't be in a hurry to cut the plant back. Wait till that bud of the iris it'll get like a brown bud. That's someplace here. I know.
Oh, we're going to have to take a break, Gracie.
Okay. All right. I'll look for that in the meantime.
You're watching Horticulturally Yours on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information about gardening, go to bctv.org.
Here we go.
Okay. I'm not sure what happened to my iris bud, but don't be in a hurry to cut them off. Let that mature, and in the fall, boy, you'll have a handful of beautiful, beautiful buds, brown, and it just looks so great with your yarrow or anything that you've saved. Even now, this is I picked this morning. It was soaking wet, and that's if you're going to do anything with design work for fall. These are neat green too, but these are those Dracaena plants that grow. You usually put them, I've seen them a lot, in the middle of a planter with things underneath it. But you can use these to do all kinds of really neat things with, to put in arrangements. Can you see that?
No.
Can you see that? Okay, but when they're real dry, they will crack. But so what you want to do, if you do save them, or mine was on the plant yet. I just took it off this morning. And it was soaking wet, so it was easy to bend into any shape that you want. And but it really looks nice if you have this. You have an arrangement, and then you can have something like that sticking out, and you can make all sorts of designs with it. So let me see.
The other thing that also people don't realize is some variety of ferns. In the fall, they will shoot out a stem out of the center, and if you cut them, they will be beautifully brown, and they add a whole different type of look to your arrangement. just the center of the fern. It's really neat.
And that's the cinnamon fern, I think.
Yes.
Yeah, they're really cool to use. And you can spray paint those also.
Absolutely.
You could spray paint them silver, gold, or whatever. But they really look nice. And then if you add a little shimmer, they have that shaker sparkly stuff. They really look nice like that also. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn the program over to you, Dieter. And in the meantime, I have a little bunny that I'm going to work on with boxwood. Boxwood is something that it'll dry. It dries beautifully. So I'm going to put it in fresh. And I'll probably just let it in then, you know, for the rest of the season. But I'm going to use some of the little gomphrena in there. So I'm going to turn it over to you, Dieter, and I'll work on this a while.
All right. Guess what, people? It is time to get your garden ready. Start thinking about it. Your catalogs should be all there already. And if you don't want to, don't like to pick things out of the catalog, come out to the greenhouse, look through, walk around, get ideas. If you feel that your soil is lacking something, go to the Berks County Extension Service. They have little packets for testing the soil. I don't know how much they cost right now, but it is a very nice service that the Berks County Extension Service does provide. And then if you tell them as to what kind of vegetable, what kind of flowers you're going to be growing, they will tell you also as to what you should be putting in the soil. It is a fantastic service that the Berks County Ag Center supplies, and I think it's a mostly underutilized service. Once you turn your garden over, this is the time. Start putting lime in it where the tomatoes are going to be. The tomatoes, especially the Romer type, the Italian plums, do have a habit of taking more nutrients out of the soil quicker than some of the other tomatoes. And what you will do is get blossom end rot. In other words, the tomato, the fruit itself, will rot on the bottom. And it is a deficiency of calcium. So what you want to do is put some lime, ground dolomitic limestone, into the soil and turn it over. And the plant can absorb it that way. If you use the dehydrated lime, you're going to burn the roots all very nice and crispy. And but it's the dolomitic limestone, the garden variety, that is the one that you have to use. Also, if you feel that some of the plants weren't as nice as they were last year, should be, then there are organic fertilizer that you can mix in the soil, like from Espoma, the garden tone, the floral tone, the tomato tone. They're all organic fertilizers, and they're very natural, and it's very difficult to burn anything, the roots, by using that. So we always suggest is putting some garden tone or some of the fertilizers in the soil so that the plant can have it. Of course, if you don't want to do that, later on, you can put the fertilizer with the water. The plants will absorb that too. I believe in both. That way, at least, if you forget one, you still have the other one. This is the time of year that you should be getting ready, St. Patty's Day. The sweet peas, the sugar peas, they should go in the ground. The onion sets can go in the ground. In another couple of weeks, I think all the cabbage family, the broccoli, the cauliflower, the lettuce can be put in the ground, provided that you are able to cover them or put a paper bag over them in case it says frost, or put a bed sheet over it, swipe it from your spouse, put it over the plants, it's more important anyway, so that it doesn't get frost. If the cabbage, not the cabbage, but the broccoli and cauliflower, you have to plant them early so that they mature early. And what happens is if the frost gets them, then it will prematurely age the plant and they will throw very tiny fruit, shall we say. Like the broccoli, all of a sudden, instead of a nice 5-6 inch broccoli, you're going to have a 2 inch one, and that's it. But that is mostly if the plants are too old or if the plants are got frost. So you have to watch it that you can cover them. There is a new chemical on the market, and I mentioned that I think last year, which is called Freeze Proof. And it will give you an extra 9 degrees. 9 degrees makes a big difference. So instead of 31 degrees where the plants will die or freeze, this can go all the way down to 22 degrees, which makes a big, big difference. So what you do is you spray this on the plant when it's nice and warm outside, and that the plant absorbs it. You can do that like a day or two before a cold snap comes, and it really works. Then, of course, the Berks Countyans, the old water wells, walls, they put them around. It's a plastic tube that you put over the plant and has water inside, and that will keep the plants also from freezing. And if you get really creative and you didn't do any of that, and all of a sudden we have frost, well, then either a paper bag or a 5-gallon bucket or something like that, just so that the air cannot can get at it. So the only thing that's blooming right now that you can put out most likely will be pansies. They can take a frost. The next thing will be petunias, but that'll be another 3 weeks away. Snapdragons, that'll be another 3 weeks away. So the rule of thumb for this area for vegetables like tomatoes or something like that has always been right around Mother's Day. Yes, we have people that are going to be, if we have a nice 80-degree day, they're going to be in a greenhouse and they're going to be buying tomatoes and peppers. And we tell them it's too darn early, but people are impatient. So they want to get out in the garden and plant things. I have no problems with that, but then pick on the right stuff. We, in the greenhouse, what we do for the customer is really make sure that the plants come in and we grow the plants. If you start them all in your home, then what happens is they get very thin, they get leggy. And then if you don't transplant them right at the right time, you're going to have a very weak plant. What we do is we put the seeds in. I don't know if you can see this. Can you see this? Oh, hold it. Let me hold it on the bottom. This is actually a tomato plant. There we go. It's a tomato plant. That's just a seedling. These are, this is March. So we planted these in February the 15th. So they're starting to grow. Now we're going to be starting to transplant them. And we're putting them into the pots. And then the next batch that we'll be going will be the ones that will grow into the packs. so they will always be a little smaller. Now this tomato plant, it's not from 2 weeks ago, no. We started these in January, mainly because these have become our famous Easter egg trees. So at Easter, we usually hang little styrofoam Easter eggs off of them, and we decorate them for the people that really don't want to have hyacinths or allergic to hyacinths or something like this, or the smell of the nice hyacinth flowers. Then we have tomato plants. And always the ladies come in and say, well, I want to give my dad some plants, but I'm not sure if I want to give him a flowering plant. Well, then we have the tomato plant that you can give him, or the famous do-it-yourself tomato sauce kit, where we actually have tomatoes and onion sets and parsley and all the different herbs in it, and it really makes a nice gift for dad. Basil. Well, basil is always tricky because that likes the heat, and we always start growing basil early, and it's always a waste of time because they just don't germinate till they're ready. Now, when we start the herbs, we also have them as little plugs. So that's where we at. Here we go. Well, this is like a thyme, and we grow them in here, and they get roots in here, and then what we do is we transplant it into bigger pots. So this one here, you can actually start using some of the thyme already for cooking. You can just cut off a little bit, and it's nothing like this is a lemon thyme, so it has actually the lemon flavor, the lemon fragrance. We have, in the commercial end of the greenhouse, we do buy a lot of plants in. Mainly, they get started in Florida or somewhere where they have a lot of more light, and that brings the plant then much sturdier, and it will make them bloom faster. So this one here is a wave petunia that just came in, so they're going to get planted now into a 4.5-inch pot, and that's what we do. Today or tomorrow, we'll be getting bigger cousins of these that will go into the hanging baskets. So a lot of times people think that we do all our own seeding. Yes, we do an awful lot. All the tomatoes, all the peppers, the vegetables, all get sowed at our place. All the marigolds, all the quite a few of the other things get sowed at ours. But like, let's say begonias, if you want to start them, which we used to do, we had to start them in December. And with the cost of the fuel, it just became prohibitive to grow them for that long in a greenhouse at 72 degrees during the middle of the winter. So what we have done, and what most of the people do now, is go to a specialist and buy the little plugs in, and they just sell the plugs, and we buy the plugs, and then we transplant them. So that makes a big difference. Instead of opening the greenhouses in January, we can actually wait. Excuse me. We can actually wait till the end of February or March. And if you burn 300 gallons of fuel in a night, so it gets very darn expensive. These guys here are plugs that just came in from a specialist. These are a type of New Guinea impatiens. These are the trailing New Guinea impatiens, and this is the way they come. Like all rooted and really nice little plants. What people don't understand is I could make cuttings off of that, but it is not allowed. These plants are under plant patents, which once the grower establishes a variety, the breeders, and then they apply for a patent, and they get it, and it is good for 7 years. So it's not like a patent like a mechanical thing that lasts forever, but they do have patents. And a greenhouse like myself is not allowed to make slips or cuttings off of these plants without the proper paperwork, and then we have to pay royalty on the plants that we take. So a lot of times now we just we don't bother with taking cuttings. We buy them from a specialist and let them have to worry about the plant patents and paying the royalties. At one time, it was, we used to do this, but we don't do this anymore. And they actually have little inspectors coming around and going through the greenhouse, and if you can't show that you bought the plants somewhere, hey, you have to destroy them and pay a hefty fine. So,
Dieter, I have a question.
Yes, dear.
The New Guinea.
Yes.
Can they take more sun than the regular?
Oh, absolutely, yes.
They can.
Yes.
And that, would they be good? You said they're trailing.
They're trailing, yeah. These
would they be good for a window?
Oh, absolutely, yes.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. And I don't know if you heard or not, but there is a problem with the regular impatiens. They have a disease called downy mildew, and it came up from Florida, and it's not a problem in the greenhouse because we can spray them with chemicals, and when you get them, they are really nice, and they hold up quite well, but sometimes if they get this powdery mildew, downy mildew, sorry, then they can wipe them out in 2-3 days. And all you have left is stick standing. If you had the impatiens last year and they died in the fall or early summer, and you didn't know what happened, most likely that's what happened. And if you want to plant them in the same spot again, don't. The spores from that downy mildew will be in the soil for at least 2 to 3, maybe 4 years. Or the temperature dips below 5 below, which it hasn't done in this area in a number of years. So be careful. You have to put more fungicide on it, and it is a little more problem. The New Guinea impatiens, the trailing ones, there are certain varieties that are not affected by that at all. And we tell the people that these are the ones that are safe to plant. The other thing that is taking the place of a lot of the impatiens is the vinca. Now, vinca is a full blasting sun type plant, and but the flower itself is almost the same as an impatient, but it takes a lot more sun. So a lot of people have been switching it for easy of not having to take care of them at all. The other thing is, if you grow wave petunias or you grow regular petunias, and they always peter out sort of halfway in between the season, Jack's Fertilizer has come out with a new fertilizer that is strictly for petunias and the calibrachoas and the vincas. This has a lot more iron in it, and it is especially for petunias. And it, excuse me a second here. But this has a lot more iron in it, and if you feed the plants with this fertilizer, which is water-soluble, and there's no problem there, the petunias will not go dormant or will not have a time where they will not flower as profusely as ever. These guys will just keep on going. Especially in the hanging baskets, I think it's one of the best fertilizers that came out lately. And the hanging baskets, the nutrients will always diminish much quicker. And if you don't feed it, plants are always not as doing as well as they should. People always come in and say, "Oh, my hanging basket died. What did you do to it?" Well, first you overwatered it. Okay, second of all, did you feed it? "Oh, no, do I have to feed it?" I says, "You feed your husband three times a day. Why the hell, why wouldn't you want to feed the plants at all?" You know, for the lazy person, there are fertilizers that are time-release fertilizer. You put it on once, and it's good for 3 to 4 months. But this particular fertilizer is the only way you can do it is by actually watering the plants with it, and it will give you dividends unbelievable. Gracie,
yes.
Anything else that you want to know? No.
No. Okay, one other question about the New Guinean patients.
Yes.
If you have a flower box that's maybe 24 inches,
yeah.
How many, because I know they get pretty big, how many of those plugs would you put in?
Two. And if
just
you really want to go bonkers, then
yeah,
put three.
Because they get pretty,
they,
I know they get a nice
two will be
size.
Plenty.
Yeah.
It's usually we say about 8 inches to a foot apart. Mm-hmm. So if you have a flower box that's only two, put one on either end, you'll be fine.
Great, great, great.
Okay.
Well, I finished just a slight arrangement here. This is my little bunny for the Easter season and the spring season. And I use the dried gumfina, and I use the fresh boxwood. If you don't have boxwood in your garden, please get some, because I use it year-round for so many things, and it does dry very nice. So, like I say, you can spray paint it. You can do anything with it around the holidays. But that's my bunny, so I guess that's all I have to say, is to get some of these flowers and enjoy them in the fall when you harvest them, and then you can make all kinds of lovely arrangements. That's it.
That's it? Okay. How much time we got left? Very little. Okay, 1 minute. Okay.
Oh.
Please go into the garden, work. It's the best exercise that you can get. It is fresh air. Get away from that TV. Get away from that computer. Get your fingers dirty. Get out there in the garden and plant something. You will be surprised as to see how the beautiful flowers will develop, and or the vegetables. It is nothing like going out in the garden and picking a ripe tomato and enjoying the taste rather than the store-bought ones.
And the little tomato. Don't then forget
that. Oh, yeah, that
sunny,
sugar.
Sun sugar.
Come on out. Oh, we have them.
I love it. That's
all
my
right.
Candy.
That's, yeah. They never make it into the greenhouse,
no.
Into the house,
no.
Because you eat them on the way.
That's right. They're wonderful. Were they sun sugar?
Sun sugar.
The little orange,
yes,
ones. They're wonderful.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Happy spring.
to the next equinox, Barry Palmer, Dr. Barry Palmer will be back. Thank you.